Assuming you haven't been living under a rock the past couple of weeks, you should know that Season 3 of The Living World just came out for Guild Wars 2. It is an enormous patch that's covered a huge amount of different things. For this video specifically, we're looking at the new map that was added to the game. Before this patch came out, there was a little bit of a question as to whether ArenaNet would go this far at all, but they seem to have done so. The first chapter of Living World Season 3 does have an entirely new area of the game for us to explore. It is set slightly to the north of Verdant Brink, slightly to the south of some of the raid areas, and it's quite unconventional as a map, especially as a Heart of Thorns map. It's quite unconventional, but this thing is not necessarily the biggest in the world in terms of the area that it covers on the world map. As you can see here, really it's nestled in among the others and doesn't take up as much space as say Verdant Brink or Tangled Depth or the Auric Basin did. And that's kind of interesting for ArenaNet, because they tend to do, until now, when they added new maps to the game, have them be quite big. There are very, very few exceptions to that rule. Places like Claw Island when the game originally came out, and I guess South Sun Cove was a little non-standard. But what this map lacks up in area space, it makes up for in verticality. The truth is, Bloodstone Fen, which is the name of the new map in reference to the same area of the world back in Guild Wars 1, also known as Bloodstone Fen. Bloodstone Fen in Guild Wars 2 has an awful lot of verticality. So today, what I want to do is run you guys through the kind of stuff you find in the map, the kind of rewards you get. Generally speaking, this is not going to be a spoiler heavy video or really have anything to do with the actual story journal steps that take place in Current Living World. We're just talking about the new map, the kind of things that you'll find there, how ArenaNet structured it, and how it's different to say some of the other Heart of Thorns stuff that they've done. So to take it from the top, you enter the map a short ways into the story. Again, we don't really have to discuss that too much. You enter this place with a big cutscene. You're on Almora Soulkeeper's airship, and well, the cutscene that a lot of you guys may have already seen in the trailer is basically what plays out. We see a massive explosion followed by a massive implosion, and it is revealed that this map is basically the aftermath of the explosion and destruction of the Maguma Jungle Bloodstone. So for how long we've been speculating we'd get to this thing in the story and we'd be able to visit the Bloodstone again, but just before we get there, the goddamn thing explodes and causes a whole lot of chaos in this area of the jungle. And that is the theme of the map. I don't really have to go too much more further with the story on that topic, but there are several things we'll find out as we continue to explore. So you start out on the sky, like quite literally you're on an airship floating way up among other rocks that have been suspended in midair, much above the jungle floor. And it's kind of your decision to jump off of that airship and glide down to wherever the hell you want. Really, this is the closest Guild Wars 2 will ever come to full-on flying, I think. What ArenaNet did with Bloodstone Fen in Guild Wars 2 is they've seen that gliding was a big hit for Heart of Thorns, and they said, right, the next new map we'll add, let's just go nuts with that flying idea. The result is that you get a whole load of different updrafts and ley lines that will get you pretty much anywhere you like, as well as a full jungle floor down there and a massive cave that you can drop into and explore for yourself too. But we'll get to that in just a moment. The other thing I'd like to say about the entrance to this map is it is kind of weird, and I don't like the way that they've done it. It's very similar to the way they handled South Sun Cove back in Living World Season 1, in that there's no real portal entrance here. Look, ArenaNet, if you're gonna drop a map into the game, at least have it connect logically into another map, right? This deserves a portal entrance into Verdant Brink, and unless I'm just being a complete moron and I've missed it, they didn't go that far to do that. So the only way you'll get here is by waypointing there, or by specifically undertaking the story journal steps that would get you in there in the first place. This just feels unintuitive and annoying to me. It frustrates me to this day that South Sun Cove doesn't have an entrance into Caladon Forest, and it still seems like the developers don't quite understand the damage this does to our sense of continuity in the world, that they're just wantonly dropping maps here, there, and everywhere, and hoping that they'll fit in various spaces. It sucks. Give us a real entrance, not just a waypoint onto this airship. Anyway, maybe that's just me being a little bit particular. Let's talk a bit about the map. It's got caves underneath, airships high up, floating islands. Some of those floating islands even have white mantle ruins on them. There's even like a white mantle coliseum on one of these islands that features pretty heavily in some of the story stuff. The eastern side of the map specifically was was where the Bloodstone was, and now that that's exploded, it's just filled with magical chaos, red energy flying everywhere, and where it once was is now a very deep gaping hole that you can fly down, where there's a waypoint called Ground Zero, and I believe it's called the Moor now, and it looks really, really frightening and scary, and you can see exactly what's happened deep below, that lots of ley line energy has gathered and made the cave down there look an awful lot like, and its name similar to as well, the ley line cave we found once upon a time long ago in Drytop 2. There is a bit of a jungly area in the map too. It's here that you'll find a stranded squad of Pact, including squad leader Bennett.
The Eternal Alchemy does seem to favor you.
Favor me? I went from nearly being executed by a giant bloodstone to nearly being blown up by an even bigger bloodstone.
Yet you survived both. I think you deserve a nickname. Bennett the Everlasting.
Isn't that tempting the Eternal Alchemy to smite me for my arrogance? There's something?
That's not how the Eternal Alchemy works.
This was a character who did feature a little bit in the raid storyline, and it's through this character that all players, whether you've raided or not, can speak to and get an update on exactly what's been going on with the story. I know I have raided, so my perspective is going to be a little bit biased, but going into this content, trying to have the perspective of someone who's never raided and doesn't understand any of the story that was presented there, I do think that this patch is very good at getting everybody up to speed as to what's going on. It really doesn't seem like you had to play the raid story to understand Living World Season 3 at all, as a lot of people have feared. Squad leader Bennett right there, in the space of maybe 5 minutes worth of dialogue, straight away explains and gets you caught up. You even get to see some of the exact same cinematics that existed in the raid out there in Bloodstone Fen anyway. I mean, what more could you ask for, really? So, the map is inhabited by a wide range of different enemies, and this is namely due to the fact that there's just been a magical explosion, and as we've seen in the past with a previous magical explosion, that of the one at Thormanova Reactor at the release of the game in 2012, this causes creatures around the world to be displaced and appear wherever that magical explosion occurred. So the Thormanova Reactor in the swamps near it, say in Brisbane Wildlands, and the reactor itself in the aftermath, had all of these random creatures that appeared with this displaced debuff on them. It was even weirdly inexplicably connected to a cave in Ascalon that was filled with crystals, where there were even more of them. This map, by the way, heavily features crystals, probably likely due to the fact that ArenaNet is setting up crystals as a form of magic, a form of pure physical magic. But so this map has a ton of basically displaced enemies because there's been a giant magical explosion. However, more specifically than that though, there are a couple of other factions. Turns out that some Pact that were in the area when this explosion occurred kind of became crazed, and we'll talk more about the story reasons for that later when we're covering spoilers, but the fact that they're crazed means you actually get to fight some of your allies here. There are a ton of White Mantle, both crazed and non-crazed White Mantle here, with some really interesting classifications. The new enemies that they've dropped in this map actually have some new mechanics entirely. For example, the White Mantle Elementalists you fight here have got this cool explosive water geyser thing. The Mesmers will create almost infinite seeming clones of themselves that are really frustrating and difficult to fight against. The Monks will buff things up massively. The White Mantle Necromancers are Minion Mancers. It's really fun and varied to fight these different groups, and also to see these different groups fighting each other as well, depending on where certain events or patrols of groups end up crossing. Not only that though, there are a couple of entirely new types of enemies too, related to this Bloodstone disaster. There are Jadeite creatures that had been being built by the White Mantle. There are Bloodstone Elementals out there now. There are kind of big versions that when you break them, they shatter into small versions, and then there are smaller ones of them, and they all like explode on their death, that sort of give you an interesting different twist on fighting the same kind of golem creatures that we've been fighting for ages. And also, as we saw in the raid storyline at the start, there's also a load of ghosts, displaced spirits everywhere, people that had died around this bloodstone, their souls had become trapped, and now the whole damn thing's exploded and their spirits are everywhere. So you've got lots of different factions, they're all fighting, they all sort of spice up the environment that you're traveling in, and some of them are available as minis. So on that topic, let's go into the rewards a little bit. That's kind of the main thing that we're going to be looking at with this map, the way that you get rewards, because obviously Heart of Thorns played with this a lot. Well, first thing to know is there are daily achievements for the map. Presumably this isn't going to be like this forever, but once the patch comes out, if you check out daily in your achievement section, you'll see that there are specific Bloodstone Fen dailies that you can do that will help you out in the map. So the ones that I've seen, there might be more, but for example, going to Bloodstone Fen once per day and closing a certain number of rifts, which are little events that will trigger around there, going to Bloodstone Fen and killing some specific ghosts, ghostly Justicars or Justiciars, gathering in the map, using some aerial skills in the map, which is a new mechanic to do with the flying I'll talk about in a second. Daily seem like they're going to factor in. Don't forget that this content, this map, is supposed to kind of hold us, maybe not entirely on its own, because this was a huge patch with a lot of other changes to the game, but this map is hoping to hold player attention for anywhere between 8 to 14 weeks or so. And so the idea that there are dailies in there is probably quite important. But so what would you want to do these dailies for? What are you actually acquiring in the map? Well, one mechanic is that you get, as you complete events, these unstable salvaging materials. So anyone who really plays Guild Wars 2 should be familiar with these sorts of items. They drop and they don't really have much value until you salvage from them, and then you might get something nice. Well, Bloodstone Fen gives you a bunch of unstable versions of that. So like unstable chunks that you can salvage for lots of iron ore if you get lucky, or unstable scraps, unstable hides, things like this. That's kind of your cookie cutter reward here, but what you really care about is unbound magic. So what is unbound magic? Unbound magic is this map's map currency. What we're seeing in effect here, guys, is ArenaNet making good on some of the system changes they made shortly before Heart of Thorns. If you remember, shortly before Heart of Thorns, they never really had the capability to add more currencies to the game, like the dungeon currencies at launch. But they changed the UI, they put it into a list format, and they did that specifically, as they said, so they could continually add new maps with future patches, and these new maps could have dedicated currency for dedicated rewards. That's what this is. This is this map's version of Geodes or Bandit Crests or Aurelium and so forth. All right. So you get it in a variety of ways. We'll talk about that in a second. Well, what I find quite interesting about this map currency specifically is that it seems to suggest it will be available in more places than just this one. So listen to this, right? Unbound magic is what it's called. And it says that this is earned in various ways at locations heavily affected by the explosive release of magic into Tyria. It's spent at vendors in those locales to purchase unlocks and rewards. Now I'm gonna try and restrain myself from doing too much deep story speculation here, but it does seem like the narrative might be going in a place where all these shards of the Bloodstone that are around the world might all be about to explode. And then that might suggest ArenaNet's new maps they're adding in the short term could be at the locations of all these Bloodstones, and wherever they add one of those maps, it's this same map currency that they'll be using. That's just speculation, this is the only map that uses it for now, but that description is very suggestive, isn't it? So what do we do with unbound magic, all right? Well, quite a lot, actually. There's a vendor on the airship you start at, who will sell you a variety of things. Some of the cookie cutter stuff that you might be familiar with from some of the other maps, like obsidian shards, for example. But there's also a lot more interesting stuff going on here too. And what I want to start off with is the flying skills that you can access in Bloodstone Fen. So, when you first load into this map, you might notice as you're gliding around, because gliding is a huge part, or rather flying, of the experience here, you might notice that your skill bar actually has completely changed. You can still use your, if you have the mastery maxed out, you can still use your dodge roll to stealth, but now you also have a skill 1, an auto attack. You can actually fight from the sky, guys. What this is like a laser beam type attack. I suppose that had to be very particularly designed. It has an immense range on it. Basically, if you can target a mob somewhere, you can probably hit it with this laser beam. But the point of it is that it does more damage the closer you are. So if you're casting on someone a million miles away, yeah, it's quite cool to see that you can do damage from so far away, but you won't do very much. But as you sweep closer and closer and closer, this thing can start seriously nailing enemies that are down on the ground. So there's this really exciting idea of this map where there's loads of of events always bubbling around on the ground. And from the skies, you have loads of different players using these interesting combat abilities to actually do damage. So that's your auto attack. You get that for free. That one's a given. And you just sort of get to laser beam everyone. But then as you collect the map currency, you can spend the map currency to unlock even more abilities. So the skill two. Skill 1 is called Focus Magic, by the way. Skill 2 is called Unstable Magic Volley. And what this is a ground target ability. You can see footage of all this stuff going on screen right now, guys. It's a ground targeted nuke, basically, where three energy missile balls will come out of you, and wherever they strike, they do massive amounts of knockdown, condies, and huge damage. It's actually quite a precise, difficult skill to land exactly as you'd want it to, but if you do get it to land properly, you can almost one shot enemies with this thing. Really satisfying, and on a pretty short cooldown as well, 5 seconds. So you just sort of swoop overhead, drop these down, and then use your skill one to, you know, needle down anything that survived and sort of nail them. Get even more of the map currency, you can unlock skill three. Skill three is more of a supportive skill. It's called Pacified Magical Storm. Again, it has just a ridiculous range. All of these skills have massive ranges. This thing has such a big range that sometimes you'll use it and you can't even see the animation of the skill cut going off because it's so far away that it's been culled out of your client, right? But what this is essentially a supercharged healing rain. What am I talking about? I'm talking about one of the staff water skills for elementalists. You drop a massive AoE that cleanses people's conditions, heals them, is a water field, and applies regeneration. And also, isn't on too crazy of a cooldown for that either. It's only about 20 seconds, and it's instant cast. You can drop it down anywhere you like. Again, there's this really cool idea of people trying to play in the meta events on this map, and their allies flying around dropping these huge fields on them, just like we saw a little bit of the Shatterer revamp as well. So then moving on to skill 4, this one's a little bit more interesting. It's not straight up ground targeted, do damage or do healing. This is called Dogfight or Flight, and it's basically a dodge roll for midair. And you might think, well, why would I want to do that? Well, there are a lot of enemies that will attack you while you're in midair. As you fly around in this map, there are giant unstable areas that will do damage to you and apply condies to you and CC you and try and knock you down to the ground, and they'll instantly defeat you if that happens. So actually having a midair dodge roll is quite handy, especially considering the fact it's got a tiny little hill on it too. Only an 8-second cooldown. It feels just like dodge rolling on the ground, except you're dodge rolling in the air. So as you can see with this patch and with this map specifically, ArenaNet really were playing with the idea of not just a flying based map, but flying combat. They gave us a full skill bar to play with in midair. And how does that skill bar end? Well, that's with skill 5. It's called Ride the Ley Line. The flavor of this is that you're conjuring a ley line of your own to boost your speed wherever the hell you like in a big direction. It feels an awful lot like, if any fans of Halo out there, it feels an awful lot like while you're piloting a Banshee, if you use the boost from that franchise. Basically, you just go flying forward in one direction wherever you like. You can cut it off early, if you will. It's got a low cooldown. The only caveat to this skill is quite a fun one. And that's that if you use this and hit a pre-existing ley line that is already in the map that you would use to move around anyway, it will instantly kill you. And the first time you do this, you get an achievement called Don't Cross the Streams. And so it kind of turns what otherwise would have been boons for you, the existing ley lines to get around, into hazards. It flips it on its head, so you're watching out for them because you don't want to accidentally boost yourself into one and get yourself killed at an unfortunate time. So those are the 5 skills. You slowly unlock those from the map currency, and in the end, what you have is a really satisfying flying experience that makes Bloodstone Fen, combined with all of the airborne magical anomalies that can knock you out of the sky, combined with all the ley lines, with all the updrafts, and one of the collection mechanics, a really, really fun flying map. I do want to stop for a second, though, to point something out that I find really weird and disappointing. One of the things that Heart of Thorns was really marketing itself on was the idea of a mastery system. The mastery system was supposed to be a way for experience to matter at the end of the game, and it was supposed to be a way for players to experience end game progression in some sense. But instead of bloating your stats infinitely in one direction and making a gear treadmill, as so many other MMOs do, which invalidates a lot of content or has the potential to, instead Guild Wars 2 with the mastery system was going to allow you to unlock new abilities that were specific to different areas of the game that maybe you didn't have before. So given that, doesn't it sound an awful lot like this whole gliding thing where we unlock these gliding fighting skills, these additional abilities? Doesn't this sound like a perfect fit for the mastery system? Well, yeah, it does. So then you might wonder, well, WP, why didn't ArenaNet use the mastery system for this? Why have they had to come up with another new mechanic for how they deliver this stuff to us? Instead, it's been bound to the map currency and we buy it from a vendor, like it's almost a skill vendor in a weird way. Well, for you, I don't have a very good answer to that. I think it's really disappointing, and I think if there's any sign that the mastery system, as ArenaNet originally developed it for Heart of Thorns, is lackluster and doesn't quite work, this is it. Surely this is exactly the kind of place where a new mastery should have been added to the game that just gave us extra gliding stuff, but they haven't done it. I think the reason they might not have done it is because they can't force you to learn the gliding abilities for Bloodstone Fen only in Bloodstone Fen, because masteries are a more global thing and they can't limit the experience gained to just one map. And for that reason, I think that the system, the system's going to need some real changes, because this was an obvious opportunity for them that, because of the way they designed it initially, they've been held back. But I wonder what you guys think. If anything, I guess it doesn't matter too much because we have another system to replace the mastery system here, but it does seem a bit sucky to me. Now, I probably should clarify, since we've already spent so long talking about the flying combat and the fact that we've got a new map currency we can spend. One key part of this map is, as you can see here, these blue orbs. So the way the Bloodstone Fen works is, how do you gather that map currency, you might be asking? Well, there are a variety of ways. You can salvage certain items, you can complete events, but these orbs are one of your main ways of getting it. The idea is you're gliding around Bloodstone Fen, collecting these, perhaps a little bit similarly to some of the experiences you might have had in the Heart of Thorns adventures. And so that's a big part of the map. You're not actually going to see any footage of me doing it today, because you have to complete a certain story step to unlock that capability, but that's one of the main places that the map currency comes from. I thought I'd explain that to you guys, just so that you know. So speaking of the map currency, the interesting things you can buy with it doesn't end with just these glider skills. They're actually doing quite a lot of unique things with this NPC. So there is something you can get for your home instance. These are Bloodstone crystals. You guys know me, I'm always happy whenever they put something else in the home instance, another collectible for us to get each day. So this is something you mine, and it will give you a variety of things. It will give you directly the map currency, Unbound Magic. It will give you Bloodstone Dust. Well, yeah, big whoop, we've always got way too much Bloodstone Dust. But also it will give you this specific item known as a Blood Ruby. So let's talk about Blood Rubies for a second. Blood Rubies are another new item in this map, and there are several things you can do with them. So Blood Rubies, first of all, have got quite a high merchant price on them as trash items. So if you have just 5, they're almost worth 13 silver already, and you can get quite a few of them. So that's number one thing you can do, you can just merch them. More likely though, you might want to salvage them into even more map currency, Unbound Magic. So when you mine this thing in your home instance, you'll get a lot of Unbound Magic, you'll get Bloodstone Dust, you'll get Blood Rubies, then you can salvage the Blood Rubies into even more Unbound Magic, so you just get a whole ton. Or, last of all, you can take those rubies and trade them to another NPC in Bloodstone Fen. The NPC I've been talking about so far is one on an airship, but actually down on the ground with the pact is a Scholar Raka, and what Scholar Raka will do is she'll give you jewelry. These are ascended trinkets that cost a lot of these rubies to get, and when I say quite a lot, I mean 100 for the ring, 125 for an amulet, or a whopping 200 for a backpack, alright? But these items, this gear, is all ascended quality, and it's stat selectable ascended quality. As far as I understand, I haven't actually managed to buy one right now, but ArenaNet did say that they were going to put the raid-only stats into a map with Living World, and I'm pretty sure that that's exactly what this is here. So this is how you get the raid stats in regular PvE, but there's also another little perk to this too, in that you can also buy from Scholar Raka, after say you've got all of these with your tons of rubies from playing Bloodstone Fen so much, you can actually also spend just a little bit of Unbound Magic, 100, that's the map currency, to buy a Bloodstone Capacitor. Now, what does a Bloodstone Capacitor do? Well, when you double click it, what it will do is it will change some of your ruby gear that you've got back into something that's stat selectable. So what do I mean by this? Well, let's say you bought the amulet, the ruby amulet, and you said you wanted it as Wanderer's stats, and then you used it as Wanderer's stats for ages. Well, later, you can just spend 100 unbound magic to change that to Vipers when you realize Vipers is a much better stat combo for the next build that you want to run. So it's like an added bit of utility. Long-term players of the game might remember an old item you could get in Living World Season 1, the Scarlet Backpack, where you could kind of change its stats for cheaper than other things instead of having to build a whole new one. And I think that's kind of the system that's at play here. It's a little bit speculative from me since I didn't actually manage to grab these items, but I think that's what Arena is doing. And it's quite a cool little thing to do with the rubies. So rubies will always have a use, even if it's just salvaging them for the currency or even merching them. Moving on, what else can we spend unbound energy on? You can spend it on Obsi Shards, as I mentioned before. You can spend it on a Bloodstone Fen Portal Scroll, which is sort of like the Captain's Airship ticket, if you've ever had one of those, where you can double-click it no matter where you are in the world, and it'll take you for free to Bloodstone Fen. Again, this is just a bit weird to me. It feels so odd that someone would go so far just to bypass a waypoint fee. And maybe it's because of the oddity of how they've implemented this with not even having a real portal entrance. Really weird item there. But much more interesting are the Magic Warped Packet and the Magic Warped Bundle. So you guys might remember from some of these other vendors, you've been able to buy like bags that have materials in them. And that's what they're doing in Bloodstone Fen 2, but they're doing it in a really weird way that I think will hit the market in a big, big fashion. All right, so let's talk about the Magic Warped Bundle first, okay? The Magic Warped Bundle costs a gold and 500 unbound magic. I know you guys watching this video won't have a great perspective for how much effort 500 unbound magic is, but hear me out. You're going to compare it to the packet in a second. The bundle is 500 unbound magic and a gold, and what it will do is every time you open one, you'll get 10 vials of blood, or 10 armored scales, or 10 powerful venom sacks, or 2 mystic clovers, or 2 lodestones. So it's kind of a really good way of getting some of these very heavy T6 mats. If we're seeing a ton of people in Bloodstone Fen for the next several weeks, or even for the rest of Guild Wars 2's existence, this could make stuff like the Gift of Fortune really come down in price. And depending on your view of how prestigious legendary should be or how desperately you want one, is going to change how much you like the sound of that. But it's pretty interesting that they've gone that way. That's the Magic Warped Bundle. Even more interestingly, maybe, is the Magic Warped Packet. The Magic Warped Packet costs half of what I was just talking about. Instead, it's 50 silver and 250 unbound magic. But this thing has a bit more variance to it. This will give you basic crafting materials or a chance to get ascended materials. All right, so as you can see from the footage here, I've opened a few, and I got a wildly different amount of things. I got 10 softwood logs from one. I got 10 platinum ore from one. 10 iron ore from one. 10 rawhide leather sections. This is not worth it. 5 ancient wood logs. But then all of a sudden, I got a bolt of damask from one. And I got a Deljamor steel ingot from one. So it's cheaper to get and with a potentially way, way, way pricier and more exciting reward at the end, but you're rolling a much bigger gamble on it that fills up some of those earlier areas of the economy while you're at it. So they've got an interesting balance here between these two. I wonder how much people will play with them. Obviously, it comes down to not just the gold cost, but also how difficult it is to get this map currency, the unbound magic. So we shall see, or the unbound energy. That's pretty much all that they have available there at that vendor, but that is quite a lot of stuff, and I do think it will take a while before you unlock all of that. Let's move on. Still thinking of rewards and things. Let's talk about achievements a bit. So previously with Living World, what they would do is they would have an achievement section for, say, Drytop, when they added Drytop, and there'd be all the Drytop achievements, and then they would have a separate section for the Story Journal achievements, and that's where all of those would appear. Well, for Season 3, they're bundling those two things together. So what you're going to find is while you're looking for Bloodstone Fen achievements, in that same section will be a bunch of story-related achievements that are kind of spoilery, so a bit of a warning to you guys. I had a pretty big spoiler just because I was looking through the achievements earlier. But that said, there are some excellent achievements that will take a while to get. One of the first ones I got, of course, was using this boost skill into a ley line, or there's the new diving goggles you can get here that actually ends up rolling you through a portal as well in a pretty fantastic way. So achievements are a big part of the map, and if you get every single one, including story and Bloodstone Fen itself, There is a meta, and at the end you get a Bloodstone crown. That crown I've been wearing in some of the footage in this video. It's really not too amazing, but I think it might be stat selectable because that's what the meta event suggests towards the end. So aside from going for just achievements in this map, obviously there is this idea of map exploration too. To talk a little bit about that, I did speculate last week that this patch may not have hero challenges in it because they don't want us stockpiling too many up for the next expansion. And guess what? Bloodstone Fen does not have any hero challenges in it. It does have some objectives, it's got some POIs, it's got a handful of vistas and waypoints, but really that's it. Mostly you are going to be looking at the achievements, and all of the achievements, specifically papers. Alright, so this is a big feature of exploring this map, where you wander around finding information about the White Mantle. You guys might remember in previous Living World seasons with Drytop, with the revamp to Lion's Arch as well, with the Silver Wastes, there was kind of this achievement that they would drop in where you had to find loads of lost coins, or you had to find loads of badges. That sort of returns in Bloodstone Fen, except they do you one better in that every time you pick up a coin, this time now it's a piece of paper, you actually get lore on it as well, so there's loads of these. Do look out on the channel over the coming week. I'm going to compile a list of every single one of these scraps of paper we find, put them in order because they're in all kinds of different periods of time, identify what characters are saying what, and I'll talk to you guys about what all of those papers mean. But it's fascinating, adds a hell of a lot of flavor to exploring the map, and that's one of the main things you're going to be wanting to do, finding these papers, figuring out who these people are, how this disaster ended up happening. These papers will refer to some of the characters from the raids, like Matthias, but again, it's not like you had to have played the raids to understand this. In fact, this is a nice healthy way for non-raiders to be introduced to who Matthias was in the first place, rather than the other way around. I'd say this is actually very healthy. Also on the map, as you're running around doing these things, as you're gathering the map currency, you've also got a couple of Maguma Mastery Insights there too, so there's a couple more Maguma points that you can get. Maybe this is setting up for another mastery tree that there will actually be in a future patch, but there's a couple of those there too. I think it is suggestive of a new mastery line coming at some point. And the other new thing that you'll find on this map, outside of the events and so forth obviously, are a new type of mining node. That's the same one we talked about in the home instance earlier, these bloodstone crystals that you have a chance to get the rubies from, but generally you just get lots of bloodstone dust from anyway. And so last of all, really the last thing for me to talk about today, are the events themselves. What is it we're actually doing here except running around collecting stuff? There are a lot of events. There's a lot of general, random, normal events like you'd find in regular Corteria, and this map does not revolve entirely around a single meta event chain, just as you've seen all the other Heart of Thorns maps did. As I've said recently, this was one of the big criticisms of Heart of Thorns, and they've gone with a different format for Bloodstone Fen. So there's just lots of little events. There's events about particularly powerful White Mantle that are around. There's events about displaced creatures in various areas. There are these little portals you can find that will blink you around, and you have to do battle in these small events that pop up everywhere. There are patrols of various enemies and displaced spirits that you might want to fight. There is a recurring event in a very specific area of a ghostly Justicar Hableon, who even talks to you a little as you progress about the map, which is absolutely excellent, and he's one of the minis that you can get. In fact, some of the enemies that you find in this map are jade creatures and golems that the White Mantle have been constructing that look just like their Guild Wars 1 equivalents, which is absolutely fantastic. But there are some metas too. So again, let me reiterate, this map, it does not revolve entirely around a meta. It is not on some kind of timer where every 2 hours a big boss will spawn and then everybody has to flood and do that and it all feeds into one place every time. It doesn't get set up like that, as far as I can see. Instead, there are just a couple of different metas you can take part in, just like many of the Corteria maps. Unfortunately, because I've been playing the map alone though, and this is why I've left this section for last, I really don't know how many of these conclude. I can speculate that one of them ends with a big boss. So there are three that I've seen. One is the Bloodstone Moor. This is where the Bloodstone blew up. These are the Cavern of Unseen Lights, I believe it's called. Well, the one in Drytop is called the Cavern of Shimmering Lights. Kind of interesting. But there's a meta event there about activity around the Bloodstone that wasn't really active while I was around. There's another meta about the haunted grounds where many displaced spirits have come down to, called the Spirits Mostly Come Out at Night. Mostly. And while I was there, it said that the spirits were at rest, but the White Mantle were in high number. And there is another event called the Fragmented Wastes, which is super high up in the sky on these floating islands where a bunch of displaced enemies and new Bloodstone elementals and things are roaming. And here it said that if you destroyed, I think it was 8 packets of enemies, if you did this before the rifts closed, you could lure an enormous Bloodstone elemental out of hiding. So I'm guessing that enormous Bloodstone elemental is a boss of some kind, but without hordes of players to do it with, I haven't been able to experience him just yet. But I'm guessing that's the kind of stuff that we'll be spending a lot of our time doing, fighting them from the skies, using our badass new abilities. And that's pretty much Bloodstone Fen for you guys. I do have another video, in case you're interested, or a dedicated kind of immersive 30 minutes or so tour of Bloodstone Fen. Just exploration, no commentary, all the game sounds at appropriate levels for maximum immersion, and I tried to make it look as graphically beautiful as I could. There'll be a link to that in the description. There are links to all the other videos I've done on today's patch also, if you want to check those out. It has been absolutely mammoth. And yeah, keep an eye on the channel as I want to talk about these notes. I want to talk about the metas if they end up really good in the future too. We'll see how everybody is finding it. So thanks very much, guys. That's the lowdown on Bloodstone Fen. I hope you enjoyed. Get in there, have some fun, and I'll see you next time. My throat is getting goddamn raw. World Season 3 that really wasn't a trailer. It was a recap of stuff we'd already seen, with about just under 5 seconds worth of new footage at the very end showing this cool badass explosion. Well, today, now, we actually have the first real trailer for Living World Season 3. I'm gonna do my best.